This is it, one of the most beautiful piazzas in the world, the Piazza di San Pietro, or St. Peter's Piazza, in front of St. Peter's Basilica in the Vatican. Hello, this is Simone, and welcome to A Road Through Travels Angels and Demons Tour.
Thousands are gathered in St. Peter's Square. The new Pope has yet to be selected.
The second cardinal was killed in this spot on the West Ponente medallion that's between the obelisk and St. Peter's Basilica by having his lungs punctured. This is the second altar of science that represents air. The West Ponente is part of the windrose that surrounds the obelisk in the center of the piazza. The windrose is an ancient diagram but added to the square in the mid-1800s. Marked on elliptical white marble markers, it uses the name of each of the 16 compass points along with the name of the wind that comes from each of those directions. The West Ponente is not always easy to find because it's often in the area that's closed off for the papal audience seating. Aside from this spot made famous in the Angels and Demons book, there are other places in St. Peter's Square that are fabulous, and some are well-kept secrets, and I'm going to show them to you. Come this way. Starting with this gate over here that separates the street from the piazza, that's basically the border between Italy and the Vatican. So, if you're over the gate, you're in Italy. If you're inside the gate, you are in the Vatican. So now we're technically in another country.
When you first walk into St. Peter's Square, you feel embraced into the immense arms of Bernini's colonnades, with a basilica at his head. A master of illusion, Bernini not only gave the piazza an impression of a space larger than it actually is, but he also increased the diameter of the columns, making those at the center slimmer than the ones at the end. And check out another one of Bernini's cool artistic trick. If you stand on one of these two discs, one on each side of the piazza, the columns appear as though they're one row, not four. Cool, huh? The Greek classical style inspired Bernini to create these 284 columns that are 55 feet tall, all in a simple Doric order. On the top of the colonnades are 140 10-foot-tall saints. You'll also see six papal coats of armor of Alexander VII located around the square. That's because it was due to Pope Alexander VII that the square looks like it does today. And it's not because it was his idea. In fact, he criticized Bernini's vision of an elliptical square instead of a square that was originally supposed to be, well, square. Bernini's brilliance was also evident when he had to deal with a large granite fountain designed by Maderno in 1613 and was set to the left side of the obelisk. Bernini used the fountain as a center point to the arch colonnade and created an identical one on the other side for balance. Pure genius.
Like many things in Rome, there's construction going on here in St. Peter's as well. This side of the colonnade is going to be in construction for a couple of years. As you can see, it's closed off and it's paid off by Wind. Wind is a mobile phone provider like AT&T or T-Mobile. Here you have Wind, Vodafone. So they're paying for this repair, so you know that's major advertising.
And in the center stands the witness. The monument that's been a quiet observer of this place for more than 2,000 years. The Vaticano obelisk, standing at a staggering 84 feet, was originally raised in Alexandria in around 30 BC. It was then brought to Rome by Caligula in 37 AD for the spina, or the center spine, of the Vatican Circus, which got its name from the Vatican Hill on which it was located. And you can actually see where the obelisk previously stood inside of Vatican City. It's right next to the Scavi Tour office, and you can see the marker on the ground where the obelisk was until 1586 when it was moved. Moving the obelisk was like moving mountains. The process took 5 months and required about 900 men, 140 horses, 45 cranes, and one soldier who saved it from imminent destruction. The obelisk almost crashed when the ropes used to hoist it began to burn from the intense friction. If it weren't for a sailor in a crowd to yell at the workers to pour water on the rope, well, we may not be talking about this obelisk right now. This is also the only obelisk in Rome that has never toppled over since the Roman times. During the Middle Ages, a gilt ball that was on top of the obelisk was believed to contain the ashes of Julius Caesar. But when the ball was removed, guess what they found? Nothing. The ball is now in a museum in Rome. The inscription on the north and south side of the base is a memorial to the successful relocation of the obelisk. But the east and west sides have exorcism formulas. Now you know where to go if you ever need one. The obelisk still bears Caligula's inscription dedicating the obelisk to the memory of Emperor Augustus. Ironically, it was discovered in 1962 that these inscriptions had also served to wipe out the memory of a previous Roman official who dedicated the obelisk to Caesar around 30 BC, but who later fell out of grace. It's fascinating to see how one religion builds on another. For the Egyptians, the pagan obelisk stood as a solar symbol representing a vital flow of communication between heaven and earth. For the ancient Romans, it was dedicated to the divine Augustus and Tiberius. And for the Christians, it's dedicated to the Holy Cross. And a bronze cross containing a fragment of the true cross tops the obelisk. The obelisk has another unique function as well. It's also a sundial. In 1817, zodiac plaques were set to mark the tip of the obelisk's shadow at noon as the sun entered each of the zodiac signs.
Another interesting thing you'll see in the square is a big circle of these little columns. From what I was told, they represent martyred Christians, and you see that they're all a little different. That's because each one represents different denominations, and there are about 60 some of them that are encircling the obelisk in the center of the piazza. They're pretty cool, that, and they make really neat leaning posts so you can be cool while you're sightseeing in the piazza. I do look cool, don't I? Oh, but I got one last thing to show you that's really, really amazing, and that is a well-kept secret in the piazza. But should I tell you? But if I tell you, it won't be a secret anymore. Okay, I'll tell you. Follow me.
Not too far from the West Ponente is a medallion called southwest Limeccio, and here is the World Cup secret of Bernini's heart. Now, if you take a look at these little stones here, one of them is the heart of Bernini, and it comes with a pretty cool legend. Legend has it, take a look to see if you can find it on your own. It's right in this area, so I'm making it really easy for you. Legend has it that Bernini was in love with this girl, and she didn't return his love. So, instead, he carved his heart in stone. And it's right over here. Can you spot it? Okay, I'll show it to you. And the best way to show it to you is to walk over to this little fountain over here. And I'm going to put a little bit of water on it. And that is the best way to show it to you. The heart of Bernini. To the right of the piazza is the Passetto di Borgo, or just the Passetto for short. In the Angels and Demons novel and movie, the Passetto is used by the assassin when he abducted the four cardinals and transported them inside the Castle Sant'Angelo. The Passetto is also used by Robert Langdon and Victoria Vetra as a shortcut from Castle Sant'Angelo to the Vatican. The Passetto is an elevated passageway that connects the Vatican City to the Castle Sant'Angelo's San Marco Bastion. It was built in 1277 by Pope Nicholas III, and it served on several occasions as an escape route for the popes in times of danger. Pope Alexander VI crossed the Passetto into Castle Sant'Angelo in 1494 when Charles VIII invaded Rome, and Pope Clement VII escaped during the sack of Rome in 1577. The door to the Passetto is locked, and the key is safeguarded by the Swiss guard. Also along the Passetto, next to the piazza, is the end of the line for bus number 62, which I frequently use in Rome because it stops at most main attractions, including the bed and breakfast I stay at in Rome. To the right, on the north side of the piazza, is the Apostolic Palace that's a complex of buildings including the Papal Residence, offices of the Catholic Church, the Vatican Museums, and the Vatican Library. All in all, over 1,000 rooms, including Raphael's rooms and the Sistine Chapel. Imagine the size of that cleaning crew. The Papal Residence is on the top floor of the palace. From the window of the study, the Pope greets and blesses a crowd in St. Peter's Square on Sundays. When the Pope is at the Vatican, you can attend a weekly papal audience held on Wednesdays. In the winter, it's usually held in a Paul VI hall, but otherwise, it's held right here in the square. I'll talk more about the papal audience in upcoming shows. Remember the red stone that marked the spot where Pope John Paul II was shot in 1981? Well, it's not here anymore. It's been replaced with a marble plaque displaying the Pope's Marian coat of arms. The M is for Mary, the mother of Jesus. Moving closer to the Basilica, there are two massive statues at each end of the palace. To the left is Peter holding the keys, and to the right is Paul holding a long sword in his right hand and a book in his left. The inscription in the book is written in Hebrew letters, "I can do all things in him who strengthens me." Both statues are commissioned in the mid-1800s to replace the previous older ones. Setting geometry and aesthetics aside, if you look at the piazza from above or from the dome, doesn't it look like a keyhole and not just a trapezoid with an ellipse on top? If you consider St. Peter holding the keys to the kingdom of heaven, it does make you wonder if this is not another Bernini symbol. We'll be right back. the next episode, we're going inside the largest church in Christendom, the St. Peter's Basilica, and see what treasures and mysteries it holds. Thank you for watching. Until next time, ciao for now.